Oh, hello. I'm Franz Spohn, and I'm here to whisk you away to the exotic world of your imagination via your creativity and Faber-Castell's first-class premium water-based materials. And now, settle comfortably back and get set to enjoy a new visual thrill. The first leg of our journey, Albrecht Dürer watercolor markers. The Albrecht Dürer watercolor markers are available in 30 colors. They're dual-ended with a large brush nib and a smaller bullet nib, which allows for sweeping coverage or detail work. They're highly light, fast, and pigmented. They're odorless and water-based, and they have a consistent color, wet or dry. And now, a few tips. The foundation of your artwork is paper. Much the same as you want a quality, sturdily built suitcase to carry your clothes on a trip, you want a heavy paper to carry the water and the pigment. I find Legion Paper's Stonehenge Aqua Paper is a perfect premium match for Faber-Castell's premium watercolors. The papers are a heavy 300 to 600 grams of 100% cotton fiber to best absorb water and pigment. It is heavily sized inside and out to provide extra working time to manipulate the washes and pigments to facilitate the widest range of techniques and possibilities. The paper comes in a smooth hot press surface, textured cold press surface, and even black. More on that later. And now, time to have fun and experiment. I'm starting off with the brush tip and then use my water brush and thin it out, and you can go from intense to very, very watery. That's the bullet point. You can also decide whether you want to keep the line or whether or not you want to turn it into a wash as well. I always use a scrap piece of paper. You can use it as a temporary palette. Put some down on the paper, pick it up with your water brush, and you're set to go again. I'm adding some water on the paper. Then I'll take my pen, put some pigment off to the side, and then I'll draw it into the pool of water and let it spread. Creates a very nice kind of dissipation of the pigment. I will caution you, do not put the pen directly in water. Okay, picking up some more here and there. Try some more experiments, add some wet on wet. The sizing in the paper allows you to pick it up, move it around, lighten it up, use a sponge, create texture. Ah, the sound of drying! You can use the hair dryer to speed the drying process along to prevent the softening of edges and leaching of colors wet into wet. Of course, this may be exactly what you want. In this case, it's dry on dry, and I'm able to get some blending by rehydrating both surfaces and blending together. Once I get going, I can start adding different shades of blue. I can build up thin areas, thick areas, light, dark, whatever and wherever my imagination takes me. The characteristic marks that the brush pen makes is ideal for doing things like leaves. With a heavy application with the brush pen and then reworking it with a brush, I can create the feeling of the light and the dark areas of a leaf. Once the main shapes are in, I can use a smaller brush, and with some water, I can push the pigment around to get light and dark area. I have shadows and highlights, and I can use the residual bit on my brush to create lighter leaves in the background. Use the bullet point for some shadows for a little more contrast, and I'm in the jungle. Flip the page around, grab a blue marker, and I've got a sky. I put a heavy dose at the top, use my water brush, go from dark to light. I'm thinning out the pigment, and the paper becomes the clouds. Who needs white paint? A little wet into wet, a little dark into light, and I get puffy clouds. The Albrecht Dürer markers are great for plein air. So another turn of the page and a quick application of some color, and we have a mini landscape. A little blue up in the sky and reworking it with a small brush after we get the background in. Just a little touch of water and suddenly we have a beautiful sky. Now let's put it all together. I usually start with the brush point to lay in large blocks of color. I use the water brush to thin the pigment so I can also get a tonal system going. Wet surfaces are often blotted to create textures to add to the mix. And I take advantage of the transparent quality of the watercolor markers and reapply pigment to build up intensity of tone. For lighter areas, I often deposit pigment on a scrap piece of paper and pick up the pigment, the water brush. I often deposit the heaviest concentration of pigment with a brush point along the edge of a shape and then use the water brush to thin it and draw it away from the darker area. Having extra paper or a scrap margin to thin out the color and test it is always a good idea. And occasionally it's a good idea to clean your brush tips or your water brush with a rag or something to make sure that the colors stay pure and so that they're not polluted, especially the lighter areas. The bullet point is an excellent tool for achieving detail or creating line or building up a texture. After the key area is fairly well established, I start blocking in the main shapes of the background while occasionally adjusting the central image as the background develops. The process of give and take, light and dark, detail, surface continues as the image evolves. I have the main focus in the center and I'm working on the outside to enhance it. And I want to make sure that the lights and the colors and the tonality are all in accord with each other. I find that I alternate between full-bodied, full-strength application, using the water brush to thin them out, and then start the same thing over again. A lot of trips for the water brush to and from scrap paper, alternating with applications of intense pigment with the Albrecht Dürer watercolor brushes. The quality of these materials, the Faber-Castell Albrecht Dürer watercolor markers and the platform, the Stonehenge Aqua Cold Press, encourages me to push beyond what I've done before. They are premium tools to help me along my artistic journey. The next leg of our journey, Albrecht Dürer watercolor pencils. The focus is on Creative Studio Pan watercolors for the next leg of our journey. They are available in 48 brilliant bright colors which are completely water soluble. A water brush is included and the lid is detachable for easy mixing and cleaning. The palette thumb ring comes in handy when enjoying plein air excursions. The visual style that I use to illustrate the children's book Shoeshine Shirley is my favorite way of working. A strong black graphic line for character development enhanced by bright and brilliant color. This approach will be our guide as we meander leisurely through our imagination. No map needed, just an urge to follow where our creativity will lead us. I spend a considerable amount of time working in my sketchbooks. I start drawing with a black permanent pit pen, and figures that are promising are rewarded with further development with color. And occasionally, I like it when I can share a page with my kid. In this case, my daughter Gina when she was 7. Pigs, birthday cakes, swans, fish. They're all in my head. Lots of black line sketches and occasionally one worthy of color. Occasionally, I delve into the land of realism, but most often I prefer drawing my mind's eye version of friendly creations. Pages and pages in black, but you can use blue as well. whether in a sketchbook or on a single sheet of paper, I love allowing the beasts, birds, and bugaboos roaming in my mind an opportunity to reveal themselves. Whether it's a herd of elephants being stampeded by a flock of birds, or an elephant performing a Hamlet soliloquy. What fun! Stonehenge Aqua Hot Press Watercolor Block, Creative Studio Pan Watercolors, Water, Brushes, Pit Pens, we're all set to get started. I'm going to begin by using a black S-tip Pit Pen. This is a permanent ink when it dries, and so it will be impervious to any effects with the watercolor. That means that once the black ink has dried, I can go over it with the watercolor without fear of the color being dulled or mixing with the black. I don't have any particular preconceived idea of what this drawing is going to look like when it's finished. I just get started and I draw and I see where it takes me. I generally don't pre-sketch anything with a pencil. I go right onto the paper. I like to trust my intuition, and it preserves the energy of the line work. To me, it's a more direct pipeline between my imagination and the pen tip on paper. After the key lines are done with the S tip, I will go in and apply some crosshatching, some shading lines with the XS tip. The contrast between the bolder, thicker lines and the more delicate detail lines, very appealing to me. Okay, figure number two, perhaps a companion elephant. So let's see, what should we have him do? Let's just have him kind of standing there. Put a little fez on him. I often put hats on my animals. I have raised one leg there. He's lurching upright in the opposite direction. And let's have him balancing an acrobatic pig on his hand. I think we found our theme, animal gymnasts. And let's have a little surprise. Mr. Strongarm Bug holding the whole lot up. And it seems to develop a little equilibrium here. We should have a cat counterbalancing the forces of gravity on the left side of the elephant. And just to make sure, how about a monkey? Everybody loves when monkeys get in the act. And I'm just drawing things as they kind of occur to me. I had no preconceived notions of any of this, which for me is the fun. I just never know what's going to happen. And how about, instead of that just being a ball on the end of the pig's nose, let's have him balance two coconuts. We'll put them in some tights, a little detail. Go back and let's kind of work on the cat a little bit. So I've developed my main theme here, and now I'm just going through and I'm adding the last details with my XS point permanent black pit pen. And I think the key image is done, so let's get coloring. I always have a scrap piece of paper handy so I can test out the intensity of my color. And I often actually pull the color off of that test paper rather than the pans. If I want a really rich dose of color, I will go right to the pan, but quite often I'll have pools of color on a scrap piece. Okay, we have our gray. Now I'm adding some detail, a striped shirt, blue pants, and Fez. Diluted pink. His toenails done there. So I'd like to let the color dry before I go back over it and start darkening and expanding the tonal range. So I'll keep on reworking the elephant with darker and darker layers of the watercolor. Okay. More detail in the shirt. Put the color down. I move it around with the brush. So I'm working on the stripes of the pig. Now this paper has a very high amount of sizing, which gives me an opportunity to put pools of color down, move them around before they're fully absorbed by the paper fibers. Essentially, that's what sizing does in a paper. The more sizing, the more time you have to work with color. You can also blot it, you can pull it away, you can remove color, because the sizing retards the absorption of the pigment by the paper fibers. I continue to add layers of color to build up the values, and generally I go from light to dark. So if there are areas that need a little more intensity to bring out some shadows, I'll do that. I'll apply a pool of pigment and then move it around with either the heel of the brush or the tip, depending on the detail or how much of an intensity I want. And I forgot one of the arms. So we'll add that, let it dry before I start trying to put color. A little more detail for Mr. Bug. Again, go from light to dark. So I start bringing in the shadows and increase the tonal range. A little shadow on the ground, that always is good for making things a little more solid. Okay, now it's time to really start picking up the contrast. Developing these really dark shadow areas can give a much more dramatic effect. Will help make the images a little bit more sculptural. Shadows, highlights, they all make these animals have a presence. Touch up a little of the detail on the cat. Meow. A little more touch up in the shadow areas. Get some of those darker tones in there. Stripes of the cat and such. And we're almost ready for the big event. And if zebras can have stripes, why not the star of our show? Besides, included in the 48 brilliant colors of our Pan watercolor palette are four intense and bright.
Originally,
I thought about Jumbo here, running through the jungle, but once I had drawn our second elephant, our first pachyderm looked like he was soaring through the air like a circus acrobat. As you may have noticed, the stripes I am painting on Jumbo are not straight. By gauging the volumes of legs, trunk, and torso, I apply the paint in strokes that describe the curved surface of Jumbo's volume. A shift in the patterns helps separate the body parts so our elephant takes on a 3D or volumetric presence. I am additionally creating a feeling for volume with the tonal range of the colors to describe how light shining from the upper left would react to these volumetric surfaces. The yellow and orange are used where light would be more intense, and green and pink in more shadowed areas. Next step is to wander away from our neon colors and select a darker green and perhaps a magenta to deepen the shadowed areas and develop a contrast in light and dark. Where are the shapes that curve away from the light? Where are the highlights that should remain bright, and the areas that are in the mid-range receiving some light? I continue to test the strength of the watercolor mixture on my brush by tapping a bit out on the scrap paper. I deposit the washes in the dark areas and then taper out into lighter areas for a smooth transition from shadow to mid-tone. Jumbo is progressing nicely and is ready to join the group for final tweaking.
Well, maybe a few more shadows, a little bit of touch-up here and there before Jumbo rejoins the group.
After all, we do want to look our best, especially if we're in the spotlight. It is important to develop color, tone, highlight, and shadow as a whole so that the entire ensemble looks like they are in sync with each other. Of course, if you feel more comfortable sketching forms out before committing to brush and paint, try using an Albrecht Dürer watercolor pencil. I have chosen a green one, as the background will be mostly green when finished, and more than likely, the watercolor will dissolve and obscure the light sketch lines. For the most part, I am creating vegetation as I go. I use the characteristic brush marks of a water brush to simulate various leaf shapes. I load the brush with a light green pigment, then mark the paper and draw it down, squeezing the brush a bit to begin to dilute the intensity of the color. I continue making marks that diminish in tone and create the impression of leaf clusters and plants. I am attempting to create a background that is softer and more painterly in opposition to the more graphic and linear characters. This contrast will help advance the characters forward visually and keep the background as the stage setting for the main image. I select the darker green and begin to create shadows and surfaces to simulate a layering of leaves in different positions and characteristics. Squeezing the water brush as I make my marks aids in the gradients of color as laid down on the paper, from dark and more concentrated pigment to lighter tones in a higher proportion of water to pigment. I begin to use a very dark green to frame around the main characters, creating a darker depth to the jungle and allowing a distinct contrast that brings my key images forward. I begin to thin that dark green down so it's more of a light blue-green, and I start adding shadows in the foreground, and I might start working on the mid-tones in the background in order to start setting up a hierarchy of space. The lightness will keep these trees that I'm developing in the background. So I've gone from light in the front, dark around the main characters, and a light blue for the background in order to set up the spatial effect of my background. Having established my foreground, midground, and background hierarchy, I will start reinforcing my darks in shadow areas. A nice brown for a ground dirt line and shadow for under plants works nicely. A little bit of light tan for some trees in the background. And a few more finesses, and I'm getting close to completing the picture. The rumble in the jungle complete. Introducing Faber-Castell's new liquid watercolors. 24 intense and brilliant colors that are transparent and can be dissolved again once applied. Perfect mixability of colors and easy to dilute. Included with the colors is a mixing palette and a brush. For our exploration, we'll be trying something a little different. Not only are these colors rich and brilliant on white paper, they can stand up to black as well. So we'll try a side-by-side run-through with Stonehenge Aqua Papers by Legion Paper. Working on black paper is obviously a different experience than working on white. When using watercolors on a white ground, painters apply thin, transparent, diluted washes for lighter tones and a more concentrated, proportionately denser mixture for richer and more pronounced tones.
I'm using dilutions of the black on the white paper to fashion a traditional sphere on the white paper. Even though I am using black, a grayscale of values is achieved by varying mixtures of water and paint. Now, let's try mixtures using white watercolor on a black ground. In this case, in order to achieve lighter tones, our pigment load on the brush will be heavier proportionately to water as we build up to the brightest highlight. Or we can start with 100% pigment on a water brush and squeeze for an increasingly diluted solution. The darkest shadow tone is simply the raw black paper with no paint at all. This is comparative to the brightest highlight being raw paper on a white ground. Since this is opposite day, on this side of the paper line, I have to paint the tabletop in a tone in order to create the dark black shadow under the sphere. It's the opposite approach on the white paper, where I had to apply pigment loads in order to create the shadow itself. Both of these papers have a lot of sizing in them, so it gives you lots of time in order to work and manipulate your watercolor washes. But that also means, because it's 100% cotton fiber, it's very absorbent. So especially on the black paper, you may have to apply and reapply the washes in order to get a really bright highlight. Okay, now let's start putting some real color in here, and I'm going to just do kind of a fade out here. I'm using my water brush. I'm getting a nice full intensity of color. I often take the pigment off of the palette and onto a scrap testing paper. In our case, I'm simply using the bottom margins of the paper on either side. With this red application, I am working to get the color field to be approximately the same on either side of our dividing line. But the overall effect is influenced by the surrounding ground value, black or white. When I create and use a black piece of paper as my ground, I often think of the theatrical lighting used for Shakespeare's Hamlet soliloquy. The stage lights are shut down, with the one spotlight focusing on Hamlet's isolated space, and other distractions on stage disappear. The drama is heightened by this effect, and for me, working on black paper creates a similar effect visually. The overpressing influence of bright light on white paper right from the start is replaced with the more dramatic stage setting for my visuals on black paper. Since we're working with opposites, let's try green, the complement color of red. Once again, in order to achieve visual parity on either side of our paper line of demarcation, I have to balance dilutions of pigment and water. I'll also add a bit of white and yellow when painting on the black paper to my mixture, and a darker green on the white paper to balance the tonal effects of the paper on the green watercolor on the black side. It definitely takes a bit of fussing to achieve my goal, but an intriguing challenge. I might add that I often use a hairdryer to accelerate the drying process. I'm not patient enough to wait for air drying, but it's important not to overwork areas once they are wet. The paper's cotton fibers and surface are most vulnerable when wet. The constant friction and abrasion of the brush over the surface can eventually pill and damage the finish on the paper. Additionally, since the watercolor is resoluble, care must be taken not to soften previous deposits that might result in muddying the colors and losing the sense of the paper's visual influence. I'm satisfied with the equanimity of the blues, having adjusted tone and chroma according to the white or black ground. And for these arching dark chrome yellow number 109, these watercolors are part of Faber-Castell's unifying index color system of pigments. It's simply equivalent thicknesses of application, no alterations. a mixture of color number 136, purple violet, and number 101, white for lavender, more white for the black side. I continue to mix and test color on the borders of the paper, drawing the colors from the palette as I work the dilution of the solution with the water brush. I keep mindful of the paper's influence, be it black or white. Let's move the old palette over and finish up with a few eccentric details. There's a bit of impish madness to my method, even when I'm just putting materials through their paces. Besides you all, why do I feel someone's watching me? It must be my ever-present imagination. Instead of using black paint to create a black circle in the middle of my orb here, I'm simply using a dampened towel to lift the pigment off the paper. The generous amount of sizing in the paper and the resoluble characteristic of the paint permits this. Instead of using black paint to create a black circle in the middle of my orb here, I'm simply using a dampened towel to lift the pigment off the paper. The generous amount of sizing in the paper and the resoluble characteristic of the paint permits this. A few more alterations and adjustments with some white paint. A series of white shapes of varying dilutions and intensities on both sides, white and black. And we'll be getting close to finishing our explorations of black and white paper with Faber-Castell's new and brilliant tubes of liquid watercolor, available in July of 2021. I hope you've enjoyed this segment of our water media journey, and perhaps it's brought a smile to your face. I know it has for me.
Darn your smile. You know this.
Okay, checklist for the final leg of our journey. Albrecht Dürer watercolor markers, Albrecht Dürer watercolor pencils, Creative Studio pan watercolors, and Creative Studio tube watercolors. First, a brief word about Faber-Castell's index color system. Each material uses the exact same pigment. In this case, number 121 Pale Geranium Lake, and that includes Pitt pens and Polychromos pencils. Albrecht Dürer watercolor markers, pencils, and the tube watercolors. All using Pale Geranium Lake number 121. This is a little warm-up using the Albrecht Dürer watercolor markers for an outline, and then I'm using some more in the background. All the same pigment, but blurring a bit since all are water-based, and also losing some shape definition. To remedy that, I am going to select a Pitt pen, which is not water-soluble. And then I can use the Albrecht Dürer watercolor marker that is also pigment number 121, pale geranium. And as I apply the water brush to create tones and move those around, the lines done by the Pitt pen remain crisp and unaffected. The detail that I'm now applying with a Polychromos, an oil-based pencil, will also be unaffected by water. A little squeeze of the number 121 Pale Geranium Lake tube watercolor, and I can quickly and enthusiastically fill in the background without danger of losing the crisp line work of the Pitt pen.
The generous amount of sizing in this Stonehenge aquapaper allows lifting pigment and working puddles of washes around in an extended time frame. No rush. In the overview, all the same pigment and color quality regardless of the medium and application. One more little alleyway to explore before we travel to our final destination. I'm using a number 156 cobalt green pit pen for my key image lines. These lines will not be affected by the subsequent water media. I'm additionally enhancing the figure with the corresponding number 156 polychromos pencil. The markings of the oil-based polychromos pencils are impervious to water washes. I anticipate where I want shadows and tonal values, so I apply a full dose of pigment with the brush end of a number 156 Albrecht Dürer watercolor marker. I'm adding background color with an Albrecht Dürer watercolor marker. I like using the brush tip. And as I enthusiastically add the background color, I don't have to worry so much about going over my key character lines since they're done with a pit pen and are impervious to the water-based Albrecht Dürer watercolor marker. Now with the brush, the water brush, I can start smoothing out the color of the background, and then I can kind of feather the edge out. I generally go from a heavy application and use my water brush or a regular brush. I move it away from the darker areas. So I go from heavy concentration to light. Now I am using my water brush to kind of pick up some of the water-soluble blue to create kind of speed marks. And I'll pick up a little bit of the yellow off the background with water and incorporate some of the yellow onto the surface of the pig. A little more blending with the water brush, working on some shadows. I want to add at this point that I have been using a hairdryer in between application. It helps keep colors pure and protects the paper surface from pilling. I've chosen a cobalt green Albrecht Dürer watercolor pencil. So I'm going to build up a little bit more tone. With a pencil, especially a sharp pencil, I can get a little more detail. I can get a finer adjustment to the tone. But similar to using the Albrecht Dürer markers, I'm putting heavier deposits of the pigment where I anticipate shadows and have them then spread with a water brush. I have surreptitiously used the hairdryer again to make sure that my paper surface is totally dry. And now I'm going in for finishing detail with a nice sharp polychromos oil-based color pencil. Wow, look at that! Pigs do fly! And now for the final flight of our imagination. All of our Faber-Castell water media have been assembled, and here we go. I've lightly sketched in my main image, and now I start off with an Albrecht Dürer watercolor marker. I'm using the brush tip again. I use my water brush to start smoothing in the tones and then reapply. Again, use a hairdryer to speed dry the surface if you're impatient, or let it dry naturally. Nicely sharpened Albrecht Dürer watercolor pencils and a smaller brush. And I'm starting to build up a little bit of detail. So a nice sharp point on a pencil can give you a little more control, a little more detail than wider brush points. I can pick a little color up from the glasses and put it in the hairs. Now I want to get a little more color. I want to be all set to go out on the beach. So I'm using the Creative Studio Pan watercolors. And again, the water brush in order to work it into what I already have done with the other materials. I squeezed a dab of the magenta from my Creative Studio tube watercolors, and then I transferred onto a scrap piece of paper, experimented a little bit with my water brush in order to get an idea of how to thin it out, applied it to the drawing, and now I'm working some tones and shadows in with the water brush. Then green is next, and I start using various transparencies and intensities of a green to create my festive holiday Hawaiian shirt. Next up, a little accent from the magenta to brighten up the shirt a bit. depending on how much water I have in the brush and the way that I work it over my palette, I can get transparent or opaque colors. A little bit of the green, full strength. I got some shadows in the shirt, and now a little dental work here, some gum work as well. So I have a very small brush that I use for some detail. The Albrecht Dürer watercolor pencils can add some shadows and some more details, kind of touch up my mustache. I want to be well-groomed, you know. The background is entirely out of my imagination. I am picturing myself in some place like Hawaii rather than the cold, snowy remnants of winter in the Midwest. Between the water brush and the Albrecht Dürer watercolor markers, I am inspired. Just every time I make a mark, it makes me want to make another one. And so in the development of the background vegetation, it's all kind of a collaboration between my imagination and the materials. I put together a series of marks from the Albrecht Dürer watercolor marker brush point that automatically creates a feeling for leaves, and then by picking the pigment up with my water brush, I can distribute it to make a lighter background yet. Ah, and now I'm in paradise.
Well, that's about it for now. I hope you've enjoyed our grand tour, and now it's time for you to plan your own itinerary to wherever your imagination leads you to. And don't forget to pack your creativity and Faber-Castell's premium class art materials for the trip. Have fun!